Tuesday morning, at 9:30 in the morning, we have our newspapers that are meet here in the fellowship hall. I'm joining them, you're more than welcome to. Our annual charge conference, which is the meeting in which we set the church budget, elect new officers, present our vision for 2023 from Alexander United Church, is coming up on Wednesday night at 6 o'clock. So that means that we will not have Wednesday night Bible study. However, Wednesday night Bible study returns the following week on the 19th at 6:25 we begin the study. And I have all the scriptures down there that we will be studying that night when Jesus predicts his death for the first time and then Jesus is transfigured on the mountain. So if you would just keep those announcements in mind, we'd greatly appreciate it. Then following our service this morning, we will have a sermon meeting, and you're all invited to stay for that as we begin our time of discernment. As we begin this morning, we all stand in the need of prayer, and it is in our prayer that as you come this morning, you will find a place of solace, a place of quiet center, where you can offer your prayers to God, where you can lift in your voice in song and prayer and know that God hears you. So it is that we sing our centering song this morning, standing in the need of prayer as the love of Christ is brought forth. Will you please stand if it's comfortable to do so? We'll sing all three verses.
It's me.
Let us pray. O God, we gather here today as your people to offer you our praise and worship. We come from different walks of life. Some are well educated, others not. Some have walked with joy for many years. Others are starting their journey. Some are strong, others weak. Some are full of joy, others burdened by care. This morning we come to voice our prayers before your throne of grace for one another. Thank you for loving each of us in equal measure. Thank you for pouring your blessings on us in equal measure.
that we may serve as your witnesses to those we encounter each day. Amen.
All right, let's pray for Luke. God, we thank you for Luke and for his life. We ask that you would continue to help him grow in your grace. We ask that you would just watch over Regina and Mac, and that they would grow, help him grow into the young man that you created him to be. Be with his mother and father, as they're away, bring him safely home, Lord. And in all things, we know that you are surrounding him with your angels of care. So continue that good work. We pray all this in the name of Jesus Christ and for the sake of the world that he loves, and let the church say,
Amen.
All right, we're not going to ask Luke to pass around our second blessing this morning. I think that might be a little bit much. But I would like to share with you just a few words about our sermon this morning. As you all know, we are entering our 40 days of discernment. And as we begin, I want you to remind you that the discernment process is not about what we desire, but what God desires first and foremost. During this period of discernment, it is our hope that God will give the church a clear pathway as we go forward. Discernment is not about winners or losers. It's about how we can best serve as God's hands, feet, and voice in a hurting world. What better place for us to start than through discerning through prayer? Prayer is a time that we spend with God, pouring out our ardent prayer requests and opening our ears to listen for God's whispers in Elijah. And for this reason, we need to find a place where we can meet God and pray daily. Therefore, this is less about asking and more about listening. And part of listening is being still in a quiet center. In a world filled with its noises, sometimes it's impossible not to be distracted, isn't it? But we need to find a place during this discernment time where we can find that quiet center, a place where we can fully concentrate on God and pray for God's will to be done in our lives. In just a few moments, I'm going to read a portion of this Sermon on the Mount about prayer. Jesus gave his disciples and his followers explicit instructions on where to pray, what to pray for, and how to pray. These three components of prayer are a good preparing ground for us so that we might truly encounter God in a new and powerful way as we pray. It is a time in which we listen for God's response to our innermost thoughts in our hearts and mind. It is a time to be still and let God be God, so that God's will might be done here on earth as it is in heaven. And that's what we're going to talk about this morning. How do we pray? What do we pray for? And how will we search out God in the midst of our prayers? We turn to our prayer time this morning as we lift up those in our congregation, within our community, and within our world. And if you have a joy or concern about any of those folks, please lift it up before us this morning. There's a couple of ones that I would like to point out that were given to me this week. Sherry Killingsworth still has COVID, and we want to continue our prayers for her. Joe Sandoval is a worker of Alan Monson, and he is struggling with illness now. Prayers of joy, it should go up on joy. He got a job at Methodist Hospital in Dallas and begins on the 17th. And so that is indeed a joy for us. For Rose Rush, she's preparing to take her law review exam in February. Is that
what
I remember? Okay. Then we also want to remember the people of Florida that have been affected by Hurricane Mike, for the U.S. and world leaders as they try to come to some solution over what is going on in Ukraine and for the country of Ukraine and all of its people. Are there others that we would like to remember this morning? Yes, Bonnie?
Thank you for your prayers.
All right.
Also, I would like to remind everyone, I do not see any cancer survivor sisters here, but this month is cancer mammograms. So get them.
Okay.
Men have them too.
That's right. All right. Oh, there was one that I did forget to mention. That was Ed Kozlowski. He was taken to the emergency room with a nosebleed yesterday. They did a rhino something to it, and they were able to stop the bleeding. But he's at home resting, and Martha's taking care of him. So let's keep him in our thoughts and prayers. Are there others?
My nephew Cliff Copus, he has had a long
back problem.
He's probably
going to have
surgery.
Cliff?
Cliff Copus,
C-O-P-U-S. All right, for Cliff Copus, he is dealing with back troubles. So let's keep him in our thoughts and prayers. Are there others? Well, God knows those prayers are most precious to you that you can only lift before Him in times of silent meditation. So we're going to offer you a quiet center, a place where you can hear God's voice speak to you as we go to God in prayer. Let's pray. Listen to your children praying. Lord, send your spirit into this place. Lord, listen to your children praying. Send us love. Send us power. Send us grace. We yield before you, O Lord. We pray for that quiet center where we encounter you and you alone, where all the distractions of the world are pushed aside and find peace. We hear the joys of life all around us, and we are so thankful. As we come before you this morning, we ask that you would help us be still. Let you be God. As you have heard all of our prayer requests, Lord, so we know you will answer each request in your time and in your way. We know that you will show us the way when we yield ourselves before you. So open our eyes and ears that we may find hope anew, that we might renew our spirit in you, and that you may come and speak to us a word that strengthens us and gives us direction. We pray for each person here today. For those who are not, we ask your blessings upon them. For those who have joys, Lord, we give you thanks for each one. We pray that they might continue in that joy as they serve you. For those that are in need of your healing, we pray, Heavenly Father, that you will continue them in your time and in your way, watching over each one of them, granting them your presence and peace. We pray for Alexander and the United Methodist Church as it goes through this time of discernment, Lord, that your spirit may guide us, your spirit may lend us its peace, pray for our world leaders and our leaders of our country, Lord, and ask bless them. God, to find peaceful solutions to the conflicts that face our world. And we ask that you would be with people in Florida as they have been devastated by the hurricane, and that they might find those of us who will reach out to them, touch their lives, grant them your peace, and keep them safe in this time. Now, Heavenly Father, help us to pray the prayer you taught your disciples, that indeed it may be our prayer this morning and forevermore, as we pray with one heart. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, and thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory forever. Amen. I invite you to please stand as we read the 23rd Psalm. You will find the 23rd Psalm on page 754 in your red notebook. Again, page 754, as we read the 23rd Psalm.
The Lord is my shepherd, I shall not want.
The Lord makes me lie down in green pastures, leads me beside still waters, restores my soul.
Leads me in right paths for the sake of the Lord's name.
Even though I walk through the darkest valley, I fear no evil.
For you are with me, your rod and your staff, they comfort me.
You prepare a table for me in the presence of my enemies.
You anoint my head with oil, my cup overflows.
Surely goodness and mercy shall follow me all the days of my life.
And I shall dwell in the house of the Lord as long as I live.
Yes, Lord. Thanks be to God. Our gospel lesson this morning comes from the gospel according to Matthew, the 6th chapter, the 5th through the 15th verse. And I invite you to hear anew the word of God. And when you pray, do not be like the hypocrites, for they love to pray, standing in the synagogue and on the street corners to be seen by men. I tell you the truth, they have received their reward in full. But when you pray, go into your room, close the door, and pray to your Father, who is unseen. Then your Father, who sees what is done in secret, will reward you. And when you pray, do not go keep on babbling like pagans, but they think they will be heard because of their many words. Do not be like them, for your Father knows what you need before you ask Him. This then is how you should pray. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us today our daily bread. Forgive us our debts as we have forgiven our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from the evil one. For if you forgive men when they sin against you, your heavenly Father will also forgive you. But if you do not forgive men of their sins, your Father will not forgive your sins. Brothers and sisters in Christ, this is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God, and let us all say.
Amen.
How about you? Don't forget, I just want to make sure that everybody knows, I haven't forgotten that it's Dawn's birthday today. We'll get to it in just a minute. This morning, as we begin the study of this scripture, I want us to bear in mind, at the heart of Christ's ministry is prayer. Does anybody remember how he began his ministry? In prayer. Of course, it was while he was being tempted by the devil, but it was in the desert
but he went to a quiet center. While there, the distractions of the devil led him to pray. We have countless examples throughout the Gospels about how Jesus prayed over the sick, and they were healed. And throughout his ministry, we find that he goes to find a secluded place where he could find that quiet center to be still before the Creator of the universe, pour out what he knew he would face as challenges, and there to listen for the voice of the Father. So it stands to reason that we must need to find a place when we can go meet this Creator of the universe, this God who knows us so intimately and loves us so thoroughly. In Wesley's sermon, A Plain Account of Christian Perfection, he wrote, "Whether we think of or speak to God, whether we act or suffer for Him, all is prayer. When we have no other object than God's love and desire nothing but pleasing God, prayer continues in the desire of the heart through the understanding to be employed on outward things. In souls filled with love, the desire to please God is a continual prayer." Wesley knew that we had to stay intimately connected to God, and the only way to do that was through prayer. We have seen examples throughout the 19th and 20th century and the 21st century. It was said that Mother Teresa, each night after she had gone into her cloistered room there at the convent in India, she would spend the rest of the night in prayer until she fell asleep. And there she would say, "Dear God, I hope I have lived as you had wanted me to live. I hope that I have done what you have called me to do. I hope and pray it has been good enough for you." Thomas Merton would live in silence for a year. He would do it in the busiest part of Hell's Kitchen in New York. And there he would go and pray through each action. Whether he saw a flower coming up between the cracks in the sidewalk, or whether he was washing dishes, or whether he was working in the garden at the back of the monastery, he prayed. So that in everything he did, he remembered who God was. Just as Wesley could not be separated from God because they were in constant prayer. This being said, as we begin our 40 days of discernment, we need to be intentional about our prayer time. I say that intentional. You know, I know many people have a time in which they go and they read their morning devotional and maybe have some Bible study time and stuff, but there is an intentionality in this time of discernment. It means that we are going to pay special attention to Jesus' instructions about how we are to use our prayer time. This means paying attention to the specific instructions and follow them so that we might find that quiet center where we can commune with God and find ourselves in a continual state of prayer. Let us pray. I invite you to pray aloud with me or silently. Let us join our hearts in prayer. God, as I come today, I yield myself before you. Help me to seek you alone in every thought,
and outward action. Let your presence shine from me. Attune my heart to your whispers, and my actions in my life be glorified by you. And let me seek you alone. Lead me to a quiet center where we can commune one to one. Now, Lord, grant that what we say with our lips we may believe in our hearts, and that what we believe in our hearts we may practice in our lives. This we pray in the name of Jesus Christ, who came and lived among us, died for our sins, and was resurrected for our sake, and the world's sake. Let us all say, amen. As I said a moment ago, today's scripture is a blueprint for us and for disciples on how we can have an effective and meaningful prayer life. These three steps are a formula that help us to figure out what we sometimes think is unobtainable in this world. With all the distractions and busyness of trying to get by, is it any wonder that our prayer lives suffer? But here in these 10 verses, we find a practical way to have an effective prayer life as we enter this process of discernment. First, Jesus begins with finding a quiet place where one can go and find a quiet center in their hearts, where only God and the individual can commune together one-on-one. Secondly, one must remember that God is already knows the needs of the person praying. And perhaps prayer time is not only about asking for others, but more intently about listening for God. So many times we spend our prayer time asking for things when we really need to spend our time listening as God speaks. And finally, in order to be truly open with God and to open ourselves to God, we must desire first and foremost what God desires for us. When we do that, when we open our ardent hearts, or open our hearts and say, "Thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven," it is in that moment we find that we are in tune with God. So let's begin our exploration of the scriptures this morning. I'd like to kind of share with you some of the things that I found in the Message as it interprets these verses. And it says something like this: "And when you come before God, do not turn that into a theatrical production. All these people making a regular show of their prayers, hoping for 15 minutes of fame. Do you think God sits in a box seat watching him? Here's what I want you to do. Find a quiet, secluded place so that you won't be tempted to role play for God. Just be there as simply and honestly as you can imagine. The focus will shift from you to God, and you will begin to sense his grace." Where do you find a quiet center in your life with all the busyness and all the noise that's around your house? I know that for myself, each morning I walk 2 miles around the church. I have a pathway that I kind of made. And throughout that time, I spend praying for the church and for you all, as I know you need prayers. And the reason that I do that, because that is where I have my quiet center. It's walking in the world that God created and set me in, and allows me to also listen. Now, some mornings are a little bit busier than others, because every now and then the school buses go up and down.
after they're gone, there's peace. There is silence. There is a sense that I cannot explain, but I know that it's gone. During these next 40 days, I want you to find a place like that for your lives. Maybe it's on the front porch of your house, or maybe the back porch. But somewhere where you can just listen. Listen for God as He comes and walks in the garden of your life. Especially in this time, when we are intentional about our prayers, we need to also be in a place where we can hear the whispers of God, like Elijah did when he was running from Jezebel. That still, small voice that speaks to your heart, your mind, your soul. That one that gives you peace in the midst of everything going on. The message says the following. The world is full of so-called prayer warriors who are praying ignorantly. They're full of formulas and programs and advice, peddling techniques for getting what you want from God. Don't fall for that nonsense. This is your Father you are dealing with, and knows, and God knows better than you what you need. With God, like with a God like this loving you, you can pray simply. We don't have to go before God and have all these fancy theological words. We can have our simple words. God, I need your help in guiding me down this road and this pathway that has been set before us. What is your way? Where will you call? Where will you call us to? These are so challenging for us in these times. Yeah. I know that when we are still, God speaks. And God's revelation comes in a time that you can't even imagine. I know that John Wesley used to get up between 5 and 6 o'clock in the morning every morning. And his practice was to spend 2 hours in prayer. Just prayer. See that when he started his day in prayer, somehow it continued. It never ended. It was always going on. Can we live our lives as though they are living prayers? Can we, as God's people, set aside all the distractions and everything that are around us and that lead us away from God? And can we say, God, I just need to hear you. And then say, I'm going to listen. There are a few places that we can go and do that. When we find those places, there are places where we can truly pray as Christ wants his people to. Our Father in heaven, reveal who you are. Set the world course. Do what is best as above, so below. Keep us aligned with 3 square meals. Keep us forgiven with you and forgiving others. Keep us safe from ourselves and the devil. You're in charge. You can do anything you want. You're ablaze with beauty. Yes, yes, yes. I love the way that he's interpreted the Lord's Prayer, because, you know, it makes it more real for me. Well, God does know. You see, what we need to discover in this time is what we have forgotten about prayer. Prayer releases the power of God. It's the grand means of drawing near to God and finding and believing. Persistence see God as God moves in our lives. That is the hallmark for prayer. He would also say in How to Pray, the best of John Wesley's prayers, he would say, in using all means, seek God alone. In and through every outward thing, look only to the power of his Spirit and the merits of Christ, his Son. Beware that you do not get stuck in the work itself. If you do, it is all lost labor. Nothing short of God can satisfy your soul. Therefore, fix on God in all, through all, and above all. Remember to use all means, as ordained, not for their own sake, but for the sake of the risen Christ. See, my brothers and sisters, that is what we are called to, a greater time of being with one another, a greater time of understanding God even more deeply. Quiet center that God calls us to is one that is not easily found. But I invite you to come to that quiet center, to be still and let God be God as God speaks to your heart. I don't know what he will say to you, but I do know this, God will speak. As I mentioned, we are going into an intentional time of prayer. It's not only scripture reading, but it's also prayer. And then meeting together with our hearts in praying for the congregation. Over the past few months, I've been working on a discernment devotion. There's 40 days of discernment. So there are 40 devotions. It is a call to discernment. And on it, I have a covenant. Now this covenant, you don't have to sign. In fact, you can throw it away. I don't care. But it's a covenant that I would like for you at least to read over, because you're going to be making it between God and each other. You don't have to sign it. You don't have to do anything unless you want to. But what I do, if you do sign it or you do put your name on it, I want you to put it somewhere where you'll see it every day. So that it will remind you, today is what we are praying about. Then I've written a devotional for each day. And we will give these out, or I will send them out, each Sunday afternoon. But we want to make sure of one thing first and foremost. If you've been receiving the church's emails, great. You don't have to put your name in. But if you haven't, I really want you to have, I want your email address so that we can make sure that as we enter this time of discernment, we'll have the correct email address for you. It's important for you. Because if we really take this time seriously and we really devote ourselves to the reading of the scriptures and the meditating and reflecting on the scriptures, and that we do indeed take time to pray each day, we will find God in our midst speaking to us, sharing with us, telling us what is possible, how it is possible. Where will we be going? God has always done this for his people. God will continue to do this. And God does not stop. God continues his work. So it is that we enter this time of discernment in prayer. I ask now that you pray with me. Let us pray. Holy God, you who create us and know us to the depth of our beings, be with us now. Show us the way and help us to be still and find that quiet center where you will whisper your words of grace to us. Help us to be attentive and aware of that presence. Help us to take time to be holy each and every day. Pray this in the name of Jesus Christ and for the sake of the world that he loves. And let the church say, amen. I invite you to turn in your red hymnals as we sing our song of hope, number 395, Take Time to Be Here. And you can stand and expect it.
Praise him, all creatures, hear me. second because we have a birthday boy today.
So,
come on up, Don, if you can make it.
I will, it's awful far.
Dad, well, you can hang on to the fuse if you need to. It's fine. You can borrow Carol's water, okay, there you go. So, how many years now of life experience? 67. 67 years, okay, that's still making money. All right, anybody else have a birthday this past week or this week coming? All right, let's sing happy birthday to this one.
Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday, God bless you. Happy birthday to you.
May the Lord bless you with many more years and a little bit more hair. May He fill you and keep you his for the rest of your days of your life. And let the church say.
Amen.
Amen. All right. Anybody have an anniversary that they want?
That was the pot calling the kettle black.
Hey, no, I shaved my head now. Come on. All right. Let's sing our final song of blessing as you hear this blessing. Go in the name of Jesus Christ to serve him in all that you will do and say. Serve him with gladness and in joy. And remember that each day he calls you to pray and to remember who he is and to take that name, not only with you, but to share it. For in prayer you will find grace, comfort, strength. Let us please stand as we sing together in the first verse, number 536. Take the name of Jesus with you, or precious name, and sing just the verse.
Take the name of Jesus with you, child of sorrow and of woes. It will joy and comfort give you. Take it then where you go. Precious name, bless me.